Imagine making £130 million worth of investments in 1 year. Yep, as crazy as it seems, that's what we've done with our investors this year. And what's even crazier? We're going to tell you exactly what we've done and where we've done them so you can do it too.
Welcome to the Property Podcast, where every Thursday morning, property investors come to be informed and inspired. This week, we are breaking down exactly where we've been investing this year. We've done a lot of deals in a lot of places. How did it match up against the areas that we said we were targeting at the start of the year? Well, listen on and find out. We've also got a news story that carries an important warning. And stick around to the end for Hub Extra, because we've got a resource that might just save your eyesight. Our news story this week is not a happy one, unfortunately. This comes from the BBC, and the headline, Rob, is devastated hotel investors fly to UK seeking their money. What's this all about?
Yeah, this is a really sad news story, Rob. This is about a hotel investment that has gone wrong. Investors have poured in millions of pounds into this scheme, which will give guaranteed returns, and those returns haven't happened, and now investors are flying in to see what's going on. Now, at this point, the company hasn't gone under, so there's still hope for these investors, but it's hugely worrying because some of these investors have put in six-figure sums into this, thinking they've got a passive hands-off investment. And we haven't highlighted this as a "we told you so" news article. We've highlighted it as another warning. We've talked about hotel investments. We've talked about student pods and how they're marketed as low risk, but are actually quite the opposite and are super high risk. And a lot of them seem quite dodgy. We've talked about this on the podcast before, and unfortunately, this is the results playing out in a particularly big scheme. So, Rob, it's really sad to see people caught out by this because they're marketed so well and they come across as safe and secure and guaranteed yields and all the rest of it, that it's easy to see why investors have been drawn into this.
Definitely, and especially popular with overseas investors who seem to be the majority who are affected here because it's a hands-off type of investment, it's prestige locations. So it all sounds so good, and it could be so good, but hotel room investments go wrong, regular investments go wrong, it happens. The best way to avoid being a victim of this kind of thing, as we've said many times before, is to make sure that your deposit is protected. We see so many deals with deposits required of 20%, 25% more. There are even some structures where by the time it's nearly completed, you've paid them all the money. But if you stick to a 10% deposit and that's either held in escrow or it's protected by a warranty that will reimburse you if the developer goes under, then you can still get yourself into some situations that you'd rather not be in. You can still have delays getting your money back. You might still have a development that doesn't materialise, but you won't lose out in this way. But Rob, as you said, the company involved hasn't gone under, so this serves as a warning, but hopefully no one will lose out.
Now, linked to this, we actually did a video on this very subject on why you shouldn't invest in hotel rooms, and that was on YouTube, so make sure you go and check it out. We've just gone through 8,000 subscribers, which is really cool, and we've only just started on YouTube really this year, so to see it jump up to that level already is fab. Thanks for getting involved, thanks for watching the videos, and thanks for subscribing. If you haven't yet, make sure you do, because videos like the one I've just mentioned are going out on a regular basis. We're trying to ramp that up now. The tax video went out recently as well. So lots of good stuff there. Hopefully you're enjoying the podcast, but we want to give you more, and we can do that via YouTube. So go and check out Property Hub UK on YouTube.
One of the questions that we get asked the most often is around our own investments. How many properties do we own? Where are we investing? And I understand why people are asking. But what I think is actually more interesting is where we're sourcing property for our clients at Property Hub Invest. Because much as we might like to, we can't personally afford to buy hundreds of properties all over the UK. But we can source lots of different types of property in lots of different locations for our clients. So at the start of this year, we identified five areas that we were primarily going to be targeting: Manchester, Liverpool, Leeds, Sheffield, and Nottingham. Those were our targets back in January. Now we're coming up to the end of the year. So how have we done? Those were the areas we were going after stock in. Have we succeeded? Well, we're going to tell you in this episode.
Now, we've done a lot of investments with our clients this year. Over £130 million worth of property. It's just mad. When we top the numbers up, it's like, wow, okay. It's all a bit crazy, but that's what we've done. With our investors, we've done £130 million worth of property this year. So this has all been through Property Hub Invest, one of our companies, where we look to build your strategy out, and then we find investments that match that strategy. And while that 130 million sounds like a big number, because it is, that's only actually just over 600 properties. So we just work with a small group each year, because most people who listen to the podcast aren't a good fit. And that's absolutely fine. The podcast is about helping as many people as possible. Only a small number of people do work with the businesses we have, probably because we don't talk about them a lot as well. It's also worth saying at this point that all these investments that we're going to talk about are gone. This is not, do you want to invest in them? This is not a sales pitch. We're letting you see behind the curtain of actually what goes on, where our focus has been, where we've done well, where we want to improve. It is risky because obviously a lot of our competitors will want to listen to this and get this information for themselves. And some people will use this information against us. But offsetting that against the positives, which is helps tens of thousands of you learn, that's a trade-off worth taking for us. So we're going to tell you exactly what we've done and where, so you can learn from it. And if you're making your own investments and doing this independently, then you can use this information to your own advantage.
So as I said at the start, we weren't keeping our strategy a secret this year. We told you back at the end of last year that we were targeting Liverpool, Manchester, Nottingham, Leeds and Sheffield as our main investment targets for 2019. And it's worth saying that we identified those areas as having potential, then went out looking for investments there, not the other way around. Because as you'll hear, we did not have a perfect record at this. But Rob, we did manage to secure a lot of property in Liverpool. It was actually the city that we did the most in this year.
Yeah, the city we did the most in, and the city our investors wanted the most. Liverpool is a really interesting market. There's a lot being built there, but there's not a lot we would invest in because of some of the developers, their track record, the size of deposits they want, or the ability to do a deal. So a lot of hard work went into building our network in Liverpool. Yes, the fact I'm from Liverpool probably did help. And about 20% of the investments we made this year were in Liverpool. So why Liverpool? Well, Liverpool as a city is massively on the up. It's still not really on the mainstream investors' radar. I know we talk about it a lot, but don't let that warp the reality. The reality is most investors haven't woken up to Liverpool yet. It's only just getting going. But there's so much to get excited about. You know, the city itself is already great. Great universities, being on the coast, world-famous city. There's lots and lots to like about it. But then there's also where it's going. Liverpool Waters, a multi-billion pound scheme. Liverpool Docks, Liverpool Gardens. There's so much going on. You could be forgiven for going, right, let's just pile in and invest anywhere in Liverpool. But as I've touched on already, you've got to be careful. Working with the right developers if you're going for new builds. But even if you're going secondhand and you're buying secondhand stock, you've got to pick the right areas. Like any city, not all areas are created equal. And with Liverpool, that is no different. You could walk half a mile in one direction and be in two very different places within the city. So you've got to get it right. And one of the areas we really like in Liverpool is the Baltic Triangle. It's walking distance into the city centre. It's the coolest, hippest part of Liverpool. It's got a tech startup scene. It's a place that people want to buy and rent right now. But the prices are still great. You get a lot for your money there. That's not the only area of Liverpool we'd love to do business in. You know, around Sefton Park is great. The city centre, absolutely spot on. And possibly parts of North Liverpool, but you've got to be super careful if you go and invest in North Liverpool. You've got to get it right. And this is where this local knowledge that we have of these cities really pays off. Knowing area by area where we should be investing now, where we should be considering, and where we should be writing off and just not touching at all.
Definitely. I've said it multiple times before and I will keep saying it because it's so important. One of the biggest mistakes that we see people make is hearing a city and then just piling in anywhere in that city. Normally going for wherever's cheapest because they think that the cheapest is going to be the best value somehow. It's never true that you can just invest anywhere in a city and be okay. And in Liverpool in particular, as Rob said, there are so many areas very close together that are wildly different. So you do need to be careful. And also true everywhere, but particularly in Liverpool, you need to be so careful with the deals. There's a fair amount being built in Liverpool, but there are so many deals we turned down there this year because the structure just wasn't right. You heard in the news story earlier why that's so important. So Liverpool is a city where our investors have been demanding the most. Even though nationally it's not being talked about that much yet, our investors are that little bit ahead of the game. We would have liked to do more than we did there, but you've got to be very careful. But our network there is now stronger than it was at the start of the year, so hopefully it's going to be up there in terms of where we invest next year as well.
Number two on our list, Rob, and maybe we thought at the start of the year this may have been number one, but where we've done the second most deals this year is Manchester. And the reason why we thought it may have been number one is it's just the UK's hotspot right now. It's so cool that it's been renamed to Manhattan. It's really spectacular what is happening in Manchester right now. We have our main office there, so we really get to see what is happening on a daily basis. And Rob, there's a real buzz in the city. It just feels like a place that things are happening right now. It's an exciting place to be.
It's true. There's something really exciting happening there. It blows my mind at how some people seem to think this is a bad thing. We had a news story a few weeks ago where the writer seemed to think that it was terrible that people were coming back to live in the city centre and make it a really exciting and vibrant place. It doesn't make any sense to me. There's so much going on. And from an investor point of view, you might think, well, is it too late to get into Manchester, given that this is somewhere that the press has been all over this year? We've been talking about Manchester for a few years, but the media has really caught on to it this year. And we've had loads of stories in the press about how Manchester is the place to invest. And we're even now, as I've said, kind of into the backlash against that. So is it too late? The answer to that is no, if you're investing for the long term, which is the type of investments that we make. If you're getting into somewhere with the view of holding for a year or two and then getting out at a profit, then Manchester is not the first place that you'd be looking at the moment, because it has had a lot of growth over the last couple of years. But if you're looking to invest in the next decade, then there's enormous potential in Manchester, and it's going to continue to do well precisely because there's a boom, but far from an unsustainable boom. There's a lot being built because there's a lot of demand. There's lots of people moving to the city, lots of people staying in the city who previously would have left and gone to London, lots of companies relocating there.
What we've done a bit differently in Manchester than compared to Liverpool is we've gone again for the best areas. That's the same. But where the strategy's been a bit more niche is that in Manchester, we've focused on luxury. Now, in Manchester, there's lots being built, and rightly so, because there's lots of people moving into the city. But what there is not enough of is the higher-end stuff, the luxury stuff. Now, there are a few pockets of it, and that's what we've focused on. So the developments that we've done with our investors, the spec is just incredible. So things like cinema rooms, spa facilities, pool, tennis courts. Yes, this is not a country club in Cheshire. This is in the city centre. And this is the stuff that is really going to stand out. And that capital growth play that Rob talked about, do well for a long time to come. You know, the best stuff will be the best stuff for a long time. And that's very much the same with the best areas as well. The best areas now will probably be the best areas in the future. And if you're not as familiar with the north, you can think about London and you think West End of London. Whatever happens in any part of the cycle, it's still considered by many to be the best part of London to live or the most desirable. And that's not going to change anytime soon. So investing in the best parts of the city sometimes means that your yield might not be as attractive, but as a safer long-term investment play, it makes a lot of sense.
So Manchester is the city where we sourced the second highest number of properties. The city where we did the third most was Nottingham, and Nottingham was also on our list of hotspots, so we're doing pretty well. Just to spoil it for you, that's not going to continue the whole way through, but Nottingham was third, and perhaps a surprise that we picked this one for our hotspots for 2019, because it's not on many people's radars, but I've got a huge soft spot for it. I've lived there in the past. I've said in the past, I think that they've got the worst marketing department in the country, because for some reason, no one talks about Nottingham, despite having so much going for it in terms of mix of employment, in terms of universities, in terms of transport links, and its location in the country being so close to lots of other major cities. Nottingham's been a tough place to do deals because there's not been a whole lot being built. That's actually why there's an undersupply of rental property in Nottingham, because hardly anything has been built for the last decade, which makes it a really good place to own property because the rental demand is high, but it's a challenging place to do deals. We have managed to pick out some good ones though, focusing again on the best locations where there's regeneration going on, where there's the best transport links. Again, just because it's early and just because we like the city doesn't mean you can just invest anywhere. So we've been picky. It hasn't been easy, but I'd like to think that we'll do even more in Nottingham next year.
So this is where it doesn't go as well, because the last two on our list are Leeds and Sheffield, and we've hardly done anything there. But why did we pick these cities? Well, let's start with Leeds. Leeds is rightly so one of our hotspots. And it's easy to see why Leeds made the list. It's a wealthy city. It's already good. You know, some cities need investment to become great. Leeds already is great, and money is going in on top, so who knows where that'll be. The financial sector is really strong there. The tech startup scene is really strong there. In fact, Leeds has the biggest financial sector outside of London in the UK. So that combined with the wonderful fundamentals, the great transport links, all the rest of it, there's lots to like. So why don't we do more deals there? Why have we only been able to make a handful of investments? Well, it's not through lack of trying. We've been to Leeds so many times for meetings, met so many developers, and there are cranes in the sky. So is it that the people of Leeds don't like us? No. It's actually that the developers aren't bringing them to the market. For those who've listened to the podcast for a long time, they may have heard me say that the developments in Leeds are going to PRS, and that's the build-to-rent sector, which we've talked about recently on a podcast. The vast majority of the developments you can see in Leeds, if you visit there, are going straight to these funds. They're not going to the market. And the one or two developments that are on the open market there, we're not happy with how they're structured or protected. So we've had to avoid it, which is painful, because actually the fact that so little is coming to market makes me want it more, because that pent-up demand for property in the city is only going to increase. And when stock finally does come to the market, we can easily see prices jumping up at a rate of knots. So while Leeds is a great city to invest in, we've not been able to put any deals together that we're happy with. So while that's painful, it doesn't change our love for Leeds.
It gets worse though, because we did a bit in Leeds, but we did nothing at all in Sheffield, which was fifth on our list of targets. We did do a deal there the previous year, but in 2019, nothing at all. Not a disaster, though, because Sheffield is one of our tips that's probably the earliest in the property cycle. So there's lots more time to secure investments there, and we'll probably see more developments getting underway in Sheffield in the next couple of years as well. It's another city that's fundamentally strong for lots of different reasons. It's got several different regeneration projects on the go, so there's a lot going on, but it's not really on people's radars yet. So still one to watch, and I'm confident that we'll get something done there next year. Somewhere not a million miles away where we did get a deal done this year was York, which is not on our target list because we thought that the market was a bit too far along in York there and we'd struggle to get anything done, but always happy to do a strong deal in York if it comes along, because York is such a fantastic city. York is strong for lots of reasons, not least all the amazing history and culture there. And in fact, my development in Moulton, which I talked about on the podcast the other week, I targeted specifically because it's a commuter town for York and I knew that the demand there was really strong. The deal that we did in York this year, though, was in a brilliant location right by the racecourse. National developer, nice little discount, so absolutely no reason to say no to that one.
But that wasn't it. We did more. There were other areas that came along, other areas that we really like, and some of them we've mentioned on the podcast as well. So some of the areas we managed to do deals in included Preston, a great city, great university, right off the motorway, super strong fundamentals, works really, really well for us. We've also done a lot in commuter areas into Manchester and Liverpool. So we've previously talked about how Greater Manchester is really interesting now as well, all the areas that you can commute into Manchester and, of course, Liverpool as well. And Rob, we did some great deals on the outskirts of Birmingham. Birmingham's a city that we've not mentioned yet, but deserves to be.
Yeah, we didn't do anything in the city itself, but we did a couple of really nice deals in the commuter towns surrounding Birmingham, of which there are quite a few. One were some flats that we got off a national developer and priced around the 100 grand mark, which I found unbelievable that you could still get that value there. This was not shoddy stuff. These are two-build, brand new flats from a national developer, about a 15-minute train ride from Birmingham, which blew my mind. We also did a separate deal in a different commuter town for Birmingham where we actually secured our biggest discount of the year. And this wasn't new stock. This was something that had been built by a national house builder 10 years ago. As you'll know, 10 years ago was not a brilliant time to be completing on stock. So they actually held it for a decade, waiting for the market to get back to a point where they could sell. So these were sold tenanted, which was great because it meant that investors got income from day one. They've been really well maintained by the developer for the last decade. And because we were able to take them off them in bulk and save them all the time and aggravation of selling them off one by one, which they really weren't set up to do in that location, we were able to get a really chunky discount as well. So even though it wasn't an area that we were specifically targeting, the area is really strong. So when the right deal came along there, we were very happy to do it.
So we talked about cities a lot so far, or commuter areas into cities, but there are towns that we really like from a property investment point of view as well. And two towns that we've mentioned in the past for their investment potential and ones for you to research are Crewe and Doncaster. Why? Well, Crewe and Doncaster are fantastic from fundamentals point of view. Connectivity, transport links, arguably up there with the best in the UK. And because of that, their employment is super strong in those areas and the rental demand. So Crewe and Doncaster, they may not be as glamorous as some of the areas that we've mentioned, but we just really think they're strong buy-to-let investment areas. If HS2 happens, then Crewe will be the best connected town in the whole of the UK. It will be less than an hour to Manchester, Leeds, Liverpool, Birmingham, London, and some of those places less than half an hour. But that's the future, but even its present is still really strong. So we really like Crewe and Doncaster, and you should keep them on your list for consideration because the rental demand in those areas is really strong. So Rob, that's £130 million worth of property. Feels quite tiring running through it all, but it's a real mix, and it should be. It should be a mix because there's not one area of the UK that everyone should invest in. There's great opportunity everywhere, and I think that's really important to understand. People seem to get emotional about one particular town or city and think, right, this is it, this is the only place, but there is opportunity out there if you're prepared to look for it.
Yeah, of course, and people get hung up a lot on the best area. What's the best place to invest? So, well, you're very, very unlikely to find the single best investment in the single best area in the whole of the country. And you don't have to. The type of investment that we target, especially if you take a long-term view, you don't have to be going for perfection. And as we regularly say, we look for very good. We don't look for perfect. Because the perfect investment, I'm not convinced exists. And if we'd been looking for the perfect investment, then we could have done no investments at all this year, because you could always find a reason to turn something down. So we identified the areas that we thought were strongest and then made the best investments that there were to make in those areas. And also a bit of a mix in terms of location and stock, in that we did lots of city centre investment, but then we made the commuter play as well, because some people prefer different types of stock, different demographics. There are lots of different ways to invest.
So quite a collection of property and quite a portfolio. Imagine if just one person owned that. But it was lots of investors. But remember, we've not run through this today to say, do you want to buy any? They're gone. They're sold. That's not the purpose of this podcast. It's about letting you understand how the professionals work, what we're doing, how we assess areas, and why we make the decisions we make, so you can replicate it yourself. Of course, if you want to work with Property of Invest, you can inquire to see if it's a good fit. But for most people, it won't be. We don't do HMOs. We don't do refurbs. We stick to just professional buy-to-let. So for most of you, you can take this knowledge and implement it yourself. If you want that help, you can inquire with Property of Invest. But as we said, this stuff is gone. We're now focusing on next year. And where will we go next year? Well, the good news is we're going to tell you in the next few weeks our hotspots for 2020, where we'll be targeting, where we'll be hoping to invest. So you can either compete against us, I know we're a bit mad, or work with us. But we don't mind. We just want to tell you what we're doing, because there's plenty for everyone. There's a lot to go at out there. But what's really important to take away, don't get too excited and run off now and start making calls to these different locations and buying anything. Do your research. Not all areas are created equal, but if you put the time and effort in to get it right, I'm sure you'll do very well.
Just before we wrap up, we've got time for Hub Extra, that part of the show where we give you that little bit more, whether it's something to use, something to listen to, something to think about, whatever it is, something that makes your life a little bit better. And it's backed up by the Hub Extra email, which lands in your inbox every Friday morning if you're a Property Hub member, which I certainly hope you are. This week, we've got a little resource called Flux. So if you're spending a lot of time at your laptop or on your iPhone, searching for investments in all these areas that we've been talking about and trying to find the perfect deal. And you could find it disturbing your sleep, because there's a lot of research that says that electronic screens emit a certain frequency of blue light that messes with your body clock. Well, Flux is a piece of software that you can install that detects the time of day and actually automatically changes the color balance on your screen. So as it gets later in the day, it tones down those colors that are believed to mess with your sleep. It's really, really clever. I've used it for a few years and you don't notice it happening because it gradually shifts throughout the day. You never actually see a change. Does it work? Well, I don't know, but I do spend a lot of time in front of my laptop and I don't have any trouble sleeping. So it's available for Mac, Windows and the iPhone and iPad as well. It's called Flux and you'll find a link in the show notes.
So we can't avoid it any longer. The election is upon us and we need to make decisions as voters. And as property investors, the manifestos that are coming out really do affect you. There's a lot in there that affects property. So next week's episode, we're going to focus on the election and we're going to look at all the manifestos, talk about the stuff that excites us, and also the stuff that scares us. And it'll probably scare you too. So we're going to look at those manifestos, and we're going to look at what they mean and what the potential consequences could be for property investors. But before then, we'll be back with Ask Rob and Rob on Tuesday. And if that isn't enough for you, make sure you join us on the socials at Property Hub UK on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And if you want even more, go check out YouTube. So plenty to keep you busy with. But until next Thursday, when we'll be back with the Property Podcast, take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.